Hello. If you by any chance are planning a holiday to Mexico, I would suggest you would visit this guy, Richie Soa. And if you go there, don't forget to bring some empty bottles for him, because he really loves that. He lives there for 20 years, and the last 20 years he's been collecting bottles and bringing them in nets. And in nets he's been pushing together and making something that floats. And one day he thought, let's put some sand on top of it. So he brought sand on it and some trees on it, and it started to be an island. And after a few years, the island was so green that he thought, well, maybe it's nice if I can bring my island to somewhere else, to take it to another country. But then the government of Mexico said, no, you can't do this. This is Mexico territory. So he's the first man who built Mexico by his own hands. So I'm not going to give you a blueprint to build a plastic bottle island, but I'm give you a blueprint to improve our cities. And why should we improve our cities? Well, we as architects, we don't do such a good job, because the cities we build are made from buildings that are for 50 years or 70 years on the same place. And in that 50 to 70 years, everything changes. Our demands change constantly because we live in a dynamic society. We have the social changes, political changes, technical changes. And even today, the most two important changes that we need and see is climate change and urbanization. And they both put so much force on our cities to adapt. So we should see what we can do with it, because I think all this pressure makes our cities too slow. Our cities are not able to adapt and to adjust as fast as we want them to. In an ideal world, we would have a city that is ready to building for change. So each time something happens, you can bring in new buildings. So it would look something like this, a city that is growing in a few weeks, new buildings, buildings going away. But in fact, this is not, of course, 10 weeks, this is 10 years. So what can we do that makes sure that we can reach these kind of cities? Well, for that, I think we should look at response time. So when there's a question, how fast can we react to that question? Well, if you're thirsty, and I'm often thirsty, in 30 seconds I can take a nip. If I want clothes, I go to the shop and buy some clothes. If I want a car, within 4 or 5 weeks, I have a new car. But if you want a house or a new building, then first you have to find a spot in a very dense city, demolish the building, get a license, get an architect, get a contractor. It takes you so much time before the building is there. It takes you more than 3 years. So if you want to make our cities better and more shorter response time, we would have to do something else. And that's change perception. It's not technology we have to change. We have to change perception. We have to have a new, fresh look towards our cities. And for that, there are two mindsets that we have to change. And the first one is that we think that cities are full. But in fact, cities are not full. We have to search for new space. And it's something that already happened for the last 100 years. There were the people who innovated the elevator. They looked up in the sky and said, well, can we use this space? And they made elevators and we can build a vertical city. Well, we have to do exactly the same. Our generation has to look at water. Most of the big cities worldwide are next to the water. Tokyo, Hong Kong, New York, they all have water, and we don't use it, not for building. So if we start doing that, then we can build exactly the same houses as we built on land, but then on water. And normal houses, they have a foundation of concrete or from piles, and a floating house has a foundation of a concrete box. In Holland, we do it for many years, and we built them on concrete boxes, and we tow them over the water through all the country. And even when we do bigger buildings, we can have this concrete and foam foundations of 20 by 20, 50 by 50, even 100 by 100, and we see houses and roads and green. And while we do that, we can move slowly from land to water. But then, of course, they are still static. So we should grow into a dynamic city. But also dynamic cities already exist. This is an image of the Burning Man Festival in Nevada, really fun. 100,000 people build a city in 2 weeks, and after 2 weeks they take it off and you go back to the original situation. So flexible cities already exist. And I think that by rethinking our city, we should also take things that we already know. You probably all have your smartphone, And before, it was always only to make a call. But today, you can personalize the things. You put your own apps on it, and each of your smartphones look the same, but they're completely different because you have your own apps. And in 2 years' time, probably your apps will be different than the ones you have today. So why can't we use the city exactly the same? Why can't we have a city in which we just move in floating functions, floating city apps? And I get a city that looks a bit like this, where you have the water, where you have the flexible solutions, and then the city itself is more the hardware. Then we go from project to product. Well, these two mindsets are absolutely important, because if we take these two mindsets, we can grow into the next step, and that is what I think floating cities. And before I want to show you something of these floating cities, I have to warn you. These floating cities won't look that different than the cities we see today, but they will act very different. And I want to show you the top 10 trends towards floating cities. And each of the trends is already happening, and each of the trends will give a new performance to our cities. So, at 10, it's safety. We're going to use water in our cities to make our cities more safe. We have these cities all over the world that are threatened by flood. This is, for instance, Miami. And when you take houses on top of the water, and even bigger buildings on top of the water, they will just go up and down with every flood that will come, or even with a hurricane. If the wind is really sucking at your building, then the building is on the water, it can just move up and down a little bit, so it can absorb the energy. So building on water is more safe than building on land. And these buildings could look like this, or even bigger, like floating apartment buildings. And hopefully we will see the first one in 2014. Online, also a very interesting trend, and that's sustainability. People have already talked about sustainability today, but I think that water will give us a new opportunity to even be more sustainable than we can be on land. This is, for instance, a design for a floating mosque. It's for Dubai, it's very hot time, 50 degrees, and of course, the water is only 27 degrees. And by pumping water through the walls, and the walls are 1 meter thick, we can cool down the building to 27 degrees, and then air conditioning and solar energy can do the rest. So if you walk in that mosque, you see beautiful, all the water going through the columns back into the water. Sustainable. On 8, also an interesting one, scarless developments. We're talking about the future and about the children of our children. And maybe the things we do today is what they don't like. So we have to give them the possibility and the possibilities to redo the things and to take things away. We are doing now projects in the Maldives, and the Maldives is a very dense country, there's not that much land, and they want new land for tourism. And we're designing over there a project which is called the Ocean Flower. It's 185 villas on the water. But I can imagine that in 100 years, something else should happen there, and that you don't want to leave any scars. So that it's built of all these floating houses, and if you take it away, there will be nothing left. So in 100 years, we can go back to the original situation. And that's not only for these kind of houses, but also for bigger developments. For instance, a floating golf course. 32 islands on the water, and connected with each other, with little tubes underneath the water, which you can go from your Kogart, from one to another. And even these kind of developments, which takes a lot of space, you can take away through time and go back to your original nice lagoon. On 7, instant green solutions. By having this urbanization throughout the cities, we get all this pressure on our green zones, and the green is pushed out of the city. Well, water gives you the possibility to give green back to the cities. This is designed for a green tower. It's called the Sea Tree. And this one is based on all the technology of the offshore industry. And it's just a big concrete tower filled with green. And here you see the original, the one in Norway. And you can bring them to your city. And in the city itself, you will see that all the animals and the birds and the fishes will take use of it, and that the ecosystem is be affected in more than 2 or 3 kilometers around this tree. Of course, one tree doesn't affect the city, but if you have like 100 around Manhattan, for instance, it can really make a difference. Next trend, We are already on 6. On 6, we have private floating islands. Same as Richie Soa in Mexico, he made the islands of bottles. Well, we do it with concrete and foam. And the rich people in the world all searching for the next big thing. You can buy a very big yacht, and it costs you like $30 million, but for $12 million, you already get this your own island. And you can enter this island with your submarine just underneath it, and the floor will open, and you can just go inside. That's something that is exactly on this moment happening. People are buying these kind of islands. On 5, plug-and-play buildings. The hotel industry is looking at these kind of developments and seeing new possibilities. This is the Green Star. It's a hotel with 5 arms. You can see it as 5 cruise ships connected to one center ring. And in fact, we're not going to build 5 of these cruise ships. We're going to build 6. So one of these legs will stay in the harbor. And after 7 years, once you have to refurbish your hotel, you can just take one part off and bring the new leg on it. And then the old one will go to the harbor and be refurbished over there. So there's a continuity process. So there's not more than a week that you can't use the hotel. It saves a lot of money. On 4, the trend, it's expanding urban fabric. Again, if you see floating cities in the future, they won't look that different than normal cities. In fact, what we as architects and urban planners try to do is to diffuse the border between land and water. And slowly, a city can grow, and even, after time, we can also take parts of it. So we go into flexible cities, and on the cities, on the water, the roads are the same, the houses are the same, and the green is the same. And if you take that one step further, to the next step, then we talk about flexible urban components. That means we have all these elements of roads and houses and trees and electricity, and by that we can grow into a city that looks a bit like a Venice with waterways. But it's also a shovel city. That means when through time you think that parts of the city are not on the right spot, you can just move it along with it. It gives a flexibility that we not yet know in the cities we see today. And it's happening. This is a floating tower for Holland. It was made like 100 kilometers out of Rotterdam and then brought all over the water and brought to the final destination. So we can already move these kind of big urban components. So we come to 2. And at 2, we have the reuse of city apps. Each 4 years, we have the Olympics. Each 4 years, we have the World Soccer Games. And each 4 years, we have cities that invest a lot of money in getting the city ready, building all the stadiums, building all these hotels. And for what? It's only for 2 or 3 weeks. So we think that there will be a new market, a market for mobile global assets, where the rich countries, like for instance Qatar, will invest in big functions, like a floating harbor, ready for all the cruise ships, so you have your hotel rooms there. And then they will just rent it out, lease it out, to countries who want to organize these kind of events. And they spend so much less money, so also less fortunate countries can start organizing these kind of big events. And then the most important one, the trend that's already happening and that will make the most effect for our future, is not one that you will see in our cities, but because it will be happening in cities in development countries. We talk about slums. Slums worldwide is one of the biggest problems. We have 1 billion people today living in slums. And all these people, there's no possibility of to upgrade them in a simple way. But if you look at the water, and most of these wet slums are next to the water, we see the possibility to find space and also the possibility to bring products in that slum. And by having products in the slum, investors are more willing to do something for that. Because if you put like 50,000 euros in, for instance, a floating school, then you can take it away on the moment that there is some eviction in these kind of areas. The risk of making these kind of areas better is getting less. We are now building a floating school. It is an internet school, so it gives access to people in these kind of slums to get connected with the internet. And we're building it now in Holland, and we'll go on transport over the water to Kampala in Uganda, And there it will be used for education. Here you can see it. It's now almost finished. And it will look fantastic. It looks like it's a spaceship. So if you go into this container, you see then 20 people just sitting behind iPads. And I have small children myself. And they are like 3 and 5. And they can just work with these kind of computers without having the ability to write or read. So we can bring this to that slum too. What I hope is that after this presentation, you will forever remember the word float. But I also want you to know what float stands for. It stands for flexible land on aquatic territory. Okay. Thank you very much.